Hello, check. All right, people, I believe we are live. Welcome to Catalysis by Vedantu. My name is Pahul. If I'm audible and visible, please write yo in the chat box. You know the drill. Yes. So, people, this is a live class. And the interesting thing is that today we are beginning physical chemistry for 12th class. Yeah. And you know that my organic chemistry is my strength. So today we are going to get into physical chemistry. So it's going to be interesting for you and me both. Anyway. Today's class is about the basics of solid state. We all know what solid state is, and most of the things around us are solid in nature. Yeah, liquid. Generally, what we use in liquids is just water and oil, mainly on a daily basis. Yeah, petrol maybe, and air is gaseous. Everything else which we interact with on a daily basis is a solid, yeah? And it is very important for us to understand all the properties of the solid. So today's class is more like an information dissipation class. We'll discuss some basic ideas. If it were up to me, I would not discuss these basic ideas because they're very obvious, but a lot of questions get asked every year on these basic ideas as well, okay? In NEET and JEE mains, questions from these basic ideas also get asked, although you can read them directly from the NCERT. Still, we are going to discuss them today. So people, very first thing, you might want to note things down, especially the examples that we will give you. So number one is types of solids. Solids are not all the same. You can see that if I have a handkerchief which is lying over here, this is technically a solid, but if I compare it to this bottle, the two solids are absolutely different. This is very soft, this is very hard, yeah? So, in solids, the atoms or molecules or ions are confined to definite positions in a highly ordered manner and are held by strong forces. This is something that you have read in your earlier classes as well. Fine. So, you have lots of strong intermolecular forces, and such solids are called crystalline solids. In the solids where every position is definite, and all of them have very good intermolecular forces, those are called crystalline solids. There are solids where the structure is not very definite. For example, this handkerchief, yeah? Does it have a definite structure? No. Do you think that the molecules over there will have a definite position inside the structure? Most likely not, because it is sort of elastic in nature as well. So on basis of these different forces which keep the solids together, we have four different types of solids. Basic information dissipation. Ionic solids, for example NaCl, covalent solids like network solids, diamond could be an example, metallic solids like iron, sodium metal, I'm sure you've seen it in the laboratory, or some other metal that you've seen, pure metal, not alloy, pure metal. Yeah. And then you have molecular solids, where molecules are interacting with each other, mostly on the basis of van der Waals forces. So let us just see a few examples of these. I'll come back to that good news. So ye examples bahut zaruri hai. Okay, these examples that we've given are very important. Please make sure you at least write down the examples. Wo likhloge to maza aayega, right? So different types of solids. Unit particles in ionic solids, of course you have cations and anions, and my dear friends, in this chapter of solid state we will eventually focus mostly on ionic solids. All the lattices that we'll discuss, all the unit cells, Bravais lattices, your tetrahedral voids, octahedral voids, all of them have to do with ionic solids. So this is the main idea that we will be discussing throughout this chapter. So the unit particles are of course cations and anions. Ions are interacting with each other. And how do ions interact each other? How do ions attract each other? They attract each other via electrostatic forces. Yeah. As simple as that. They attract each other via electrostatic forces. So positive charge attracting negative charge, the very fundamental idea of the building of this universe. Positive charge will attract negative charge. That is how these ionic solids are sustainable. Now, what are the properties? They are hard. Yes, they're pretty hard. They are brittle. My dear friends, do you understand the meaning of the word brittle? I'm sure you have studied this in the properties of metals earlier. Yeah. So hard to apne ko sabko samajh aata tha. Hard is, you know, solid. What is brittle? See, if you have a pure ionic solid, it is brittle. Brittle means you can break it apart into smaller crystals. Have you seen the crystals of rock salt? Wo bada wala crystal dekha kabhi salt ka? Have you seen it? Maybe just an image. Or if you have bought crystal salt, kabhi bazaar mein jana, go to the market and try to look for crystal salt instead of normal common table salt. Okay, so crystal salt, where the crystals are very huge, but as soon as you crush them, it gets crushed very easily. Or let's say you have chalo, sugar is not a very good example of ionic solid. It is not an ionic solid, but anyway, as you know, they can break apart very easily.
Okay,
easily broken. Okay, so crystalline solids, ionic crystalline solids are brittle. They have high melting points. That's why we have them as solids. Okay, they are electrical insulators. You can't pass electricity through them if they are in the solid state. Okay, electrical insulators in solid state. In liquid state, they can conduct electricity because their ions are now free to move. In aqueous state as well. Do you understand the difference between liquid state and aqueous state? Liquid state is when you melt them down. Yeah, you've provided such a high temperature that now the solid has melted. Molten solid. On the other side, aqueous is when you dissolve it in water. When you take salt and dissolve it in water, that is aqueous. So always make sure you understand the difference between aqueous and liquid. Now, in liquid and aqueous solutions, these are electrically conducting in nature, but solid solutions are electrically insulating in nature. Very interesting. So examples are NaCl, LiF, BSO4. Sabko pata hai example to ghatiya. No need to spend more time on examples. So let's move on to covalent solids now. So in covalent solids, of course, you would have covalent bonds. Ionic solids have ionic bonds, covalent solids would have, surprise, surprise, covalent bonds. Very nice. So, the constituents are atoms. Atoms are bonded to each other via covalent bonds. Yeah. And what could be the examples? Diamond. Very famous example is diamond. Very strong structure. Yeah. Then you also have silica, quartz, basically SiO2. Yeah, you know multiple forms of SiO2 exist. Yeah, in your P block chapter, when you read P block chapter, you will learn that SiO2, silicate, silica can exist in multiple different forms. Okay, so kisi mein structure is this way, in some cases the structure is a little different. So all of those are your covalent solids. Okay, so they are also pretty hard, as we know from diamond. They are also highly, you know, they have very high melting points. Take sand for example. Yeah, take sand for example. Now sand, in a lot of areas in the world, even in India, sand is used for cooking. Yeah, have you seen those videos on YouTube or National Geographic or any place where they take a lot of sand and heat up the sand and then put an entire chicken into the sand and then it keeps cooking for a very long time? Or the more easy example would be, have you had peanuts on the roadside? Kabhi thele pe jaake chakna khaya peanuts? Yeah. So those peanuts are essentially roasted in sand. I'm pretty sure you've seen that technique. So that is because they can retain a lot of heat and not melt easily. They are also non-conducting in nature, which is very good. So these are the ideas about ionic and covalent solids. Again, rest of the ideas are pretty obvious. Make sure you remember the examples. Now let me move on to the next two categories. These are not that obvious. Ionic and covalent solids are very obvious categories because we know their examples very well. Table salt, ionic, diamond, covalent. Now let us see what are metallic solids and molecular solids. This is still easier to understand. This is not that easy to understand because we don't have a lot of examples around us. As I give you an example, you will be able to understand it better. So first you have metallic solids. My dear friends, what are metallic solids? Positive ions in a sea of electrons. Ye kya cheez hai bhaiya? What does this mean? I'll just give you a very simple example. Okay, you have heard that metals are conducting in nature. Yes. Imagine we have sodium metal. So what will happen? Sodium will be next to another sodium, 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 etc., etc. And the way their bonding works is, that their valence electrons, okay, sodium will have 1, 1, 1, 1 valence electron. So their valence electrons essentially start being on the surface, almost like this. Okay. So their bonding is as such that when they bond together, their valence electrons essentially rise to the surface. Essentially, this is just a simplified version that I'm giving you. Okay. So hota kya hai, when you provide them electricity, yeah, when you provide electricity, these can start moving around. Yeah, and that is why they can conduct electricity. So you can think about them as positive ions in a sea of electrons. This is how you can visualize them. All right. Otherwise, the metallic bonds are really complicated in nature. I have learnt about metallic bonds in college. So what happens is when sodium comes close to sodium and another sodium comes close and another sodium comes close, what happens is that their atomic orbitals combine together in molecular orbitals in such a manner that the valence shell becomes a valence band. Let me give you an idea. Okay. Do you want me to give you an idea, by the way? If you want the idea, just write idea in the chat box. Yeah, I'll give you an idea of what I have learned in college. Thoda sa idea dunga, what's going on in metallic bonding. You might have read about that somewhere online in semiconductors, etc. But theek hai, main batata hu. Idea de deta hu. Chalo, Yogendra wants the idea. Anirudh also wants the idea. And Shivangi is asking for alcohol. Shivangi, why, beta? Why do you want alcohol? Okay, well, lots of people are asking for the idea. Anyway, chalo, theek hai. Alcohol, phenol, ether kyun chal raha hai? I've already taken classes on that. You can go and watch it in case you want. So, chalo, ho kya raha hai yahan pe? There is a sodium atom. It has some atomic orbitals. Yeah. Another sodium atom, it has some atomic orbitals. Another sodium atom, it has some atomic orbitals. I'm just giving you a simplified idea once again. People, imagine this is one energy level, this is one energy level, this is one energy level, this is one energy level. There are four energy levels in which the electrons can exist. Electron can either be here. I know the green pin is not very visible. Electron can either be here, or it can be here, or it can go here. It can exist in these four energy levels. Now imagine. Imagine that these energy levels are very close to each other. Do you realize it is very easy for me? It is very easy for me to move the electron from here to here. My statement is, as the energy gap between these different energy levels keeps coming closer, it becomes easier for me to move the electron. Energy gap is lesser. Electron movement is easier. Now, what happens when all those metals come together, their molecular orbitals, essentially when that they get formed? The energy levels are very close to each other in that. In fact, when so many metals come together, all of their orbitals are interacting. Eventually, what happens is that instead of getting these separate energy levels, you start getting an energy level band. The energy levels are so close. The energy levels are so close that the movement of electrons in it, okay, the movement of electrons in it is almost continuous, or I would say as good as continuous. Yeah. So instead of having separate energy levels in the molecular orbitals of a metallic bonding system, you essentially start having a band. Yeah. Homo band, lumo band, hote hai, highest occupied molecular orbital, lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. You will read about them more when you go into college. Theek hai? So they are as good as a continuous band. And because the movement of electrons in these bands is so easy, that is why they are conducting in nature. So this is just a very simplified version of the metallic bond that I've told you. You can read more about it on Wikipedia if you want later. Do some research on your own. Anyway, so that's what metallic bonds are. So they can be very soft. They can be very hard as well. Yeah, you know, pure sodium is very soft. You know, pure gold is very soft. Pure iron is also not very hard. It is considerably hard, but not very hard. Copper, aluminium, they're generally harder. Yeah, so soft to very hard. They have low to high melting points. Again, variations exist. Sodium is softer, aluminium is harder, etc. Good thermal and electrical conductivity. I explained you how and why as well. Instead of having different separate energy levels, instead of having to give lots of energy for the electron to move away, the energy levels are as good as a band. So, tiny amount of energy can move the electron away from the metal. Okay? So, good thermal and electrical conductivity, examples are aluminium, sodium, copper, etc. Pata hi hai. Metallic solids, done. Now, finally, you have molecular solids, and questions on the molecular solids get asked in JEE Mains and NEET. What they will do is, they will give you a few examples and they'll ask you how many of them are molecular solids. Or they may ask you molecular solids and then choose one option from the options given. Again, their constituents are molecules or atoms. Now, the thing is that they are not really bonded to each other. Okay? They are not covalent bonded to each other. So, yahan likh do, no covalent bond. Okay, that's the fun thing about molecular solids. There's no covalent bond in them. How are they then attracted to each other? How are they supposed to stick with each other? Via dipole-dipole interactions or van der Waals forces or hydrogen bonding. And you realize that these forces, okay, these forces are generally weak, isn't it? They are not as strong as a covalent bond. They are weak forces, yaar. Hai na? Air exists around us. How does air stick together? Because of van der Waals forces. So, my dear friends, molecular solids generally exist at very low temperatures. Okay? Most of the molecular solids that exist, exist only at low temperatures. Because at room temperature, at higher temperatures, they will exist mostly as liquids or gases. Theek hai? So, generally, ye exist karte bahut hi low temperature pe. Fine. So, dipole-dipole interactions, van der Waals forces, etc., etc. So, they can be soft because as I told you, their interactions are very weak. They are soft. Theek hai? They have low to moderately high melting point. Mostly, it is very low. But sometimes in the case of, let's say, iodine, it can be a little higher than the other molecular solids. Theek hai? They are insulators in nature, once again, pretty obvious. They can't conduct electricity. Metallic solids are the only solids which in solid state can conduct electricity. All the other solids can't conduct electricity in solid state. Yeah. So, one example is dry ice. Do you understand dry ice? Solid carbon dioxide. Yeah. Some of you might have seen it online, yeah, when they use dry ice to create a lot of fake smoke. So they have solid CO2, and as soon as it comes in touch with the atmosphere, as soon as you put it in normal room temperature, it starts to turn into a gas. Yeah. So dry ice is one example. Argon is one example. Phosphorus is one example. So these examples are not very common. Most of us have not seen these examples. So again, take it with a pinch of salt. हो सकता अच्छे से दिमाग में एग्जाम्पल ना आए बट ठीक है समझने की कोशिश करो दे आर लो टू मॉडरेटली हाई मेल्टिंग पॉइंट दे आर प्रिटी सॉफ्ट एंड दे आर इंसुलेटर्स ठीक है कूल वीरा इज आस्किंग सर व्हेन विल क्लास 12 सिलेबस कंप्लीट सी वी विल ट्राई टू कंप्लीट फिजिकल केमिस्ट्री इन द नेक्स्ट 2 to 3 months सो सेप्टेम्बर इज देयर अक्टूबर इज देयर बाय नवंबर आई थिंक मिड नवंबर और एंड नवंबर वी शुड बी डन विद most of the 12th class syllabus. That's my projection now. Only time will tell. Theek hai? Sugash is asking, sir, what's the schedule? So, Sugash, the schedule right now is Monday, Wednesday and Friday. 12th class students ka class hoga. So, all these solid state classes will happen on Monday, Wednesday and Friday. Okay? And for you 11th class students who want to study 11th class, the classes are on Tuesday, Thursday and Saturday at 7 p.m. So, regular classes on this channel keep happening on at 7 p.m. Monday to Saturday. For 2020 students, we will continue something or the other this month as well. I am doing a NEET mock test today and eventually I'll start a JEE Advanced series as well. So, that will happen Monday to Friday at 8:30 p.m. Okay? Trishank is asking for ring expansions. Trishank, we'll talk about that later. Just leave a comment. I'll find where I've done that and I'll send you. Okay? Adi is asking, what is super cooled liquid? I'll talk about a super cooled liquid. ठीक है मैं बताऊंगा समृद्ध बाय बाय ओके एंड अथर्व इज आस्किंग व्हेन विल वी स्टार्ट इनऑर्गेनिक अथर्व सो द थिंग इज इनऑर्गेनिक इज इजी टू बी स्टडीड बाय सेल्फ ठीक है तुम खुद से स्टडी कर सकते हो इनऑर्गेनिक सो डू वन थिंग इन माय लेट्स रेविट सीरीज There's a playlist called Let's Revit. Just open that playlist and you can search for S block, P block, coordination chemistry etc so wo dekhna ek bari you'll be able to learn a lot about inorganic from there Anukirtana is saying waiting for organic chemistry Anukirtana we are done with organic chemistry okay we've already covered the entire section of organic chemistry on this channel so please go to the playlist and check out whatever you want to all right ab khatam kar chuke hain yaar prem I do not give out pdfs that is one thing that I have on this channel I give out PDFs only for tests, not for regular classes. You have to make your own notes because if I give you PDFs, it's better I give the examination for you. You have to put your own efforts. If you revise from your own notes, much better later on. If you think my PDFs will help you revise later, forget about it. Chalo, theek hai? So, ye sab ho gaya. Now, the questions that are coming in are about the things that I'm going to discuss very soon. Solids ho gaye, depending on different types of bonds, ionic, covalent, metallic, molecular. Now, my dear friends, there are other ways to classify solids as well. And then comes the classification between crystalline and amorphous. Do you remember this distinction? You have read about crystalline and amorphous solids earlier in your 8th, 9th, 10th classes. I don't know when. Now the syllabus has changed a little from when I was in 9th and 10th. So I have learned this idea in 8th or 9th class, I think. Crystalline versus amorphous. Where do you discuss this idea? Do you remember? You discussed this idea while talking about the allotropes of carbon. Yeah, remember? When you discuss about... when you discuss about diamond versus coal, when you discuss about graphite versus coke, other forms of carbon, that is, then you discuss crystalline versus amorphous. So the ideas are pretty similar. Crystalline solids have definite and regular geometry with flat surfaces and sharp edges. Pretty obvious, aisa crystal rahega. The crystal is very uniform, so it has a very defined geometry to it. Yeah, amorphous on the other hand don't have a definite geometry. They are concentrated in some area, they are not concentrated in some area. So again, differences are same. Diamond versus coal. Yeah, hira or koila. That is the difference. Yeah, so they have sharp melting points. They will melt at a very definite melting point. See why? Because their arrangement is uniform. Each and every part of the crystalline structure is the same. Yeah, so when one part melts, the other part is supposed to melt. In the case of amorphous solids, what happens is that one part is a little densely packed, the other side of the solid is a little loose. Yeah, the other side of the solid is doing something else altogether. So this will melt later, the loose one will melt earlier. So in amorphous solids, they don't have a definite melting point. Some part of the solid will melt at one temperature, then you keep increasing, then the other part of the solid will melt, because the structure overall is not uniform. Yeah, so they don't have sharp melting points. They don't have definite melting points. So sharp means definite. So amorphous solids generally have a range in which they melt. Crystalline solids have a set melting point. Crystalline solids are anisotropic. That is, some electrical and mechanical properties are different in different directions. Exception is cubic crystals. What does this mean? Iska kya matlab hai ab? Okay, crystalline solids are anisotropic, amorphous solids are isotropic. Their physical properties have same values in all directions. What is this? I'll tell you. Think about a theoretical crystal. Okay, think about a theoretical crystal, and the crystal is made up of these red circles. Okay, so this is how they are arranged in the x-axis. We'll think about their arrangement in x-axis and y-axis. Okay, this is how they are arranged in the x-axis. Cool, at uniform distance from each other. This is their arrangement in x-axis. Fine. Now in y-axis, we see that their arrangement is slightly different. How is it different? The distance between these particles in the y-axis is a little higher. This is a very simple example. Okay. X-axis mein they are close to each other. In the y-axis, they are a little further from each other. Theek hai? Slight difference. Can you see? X-axis mein they are closer to each other. Y-axis mein they are a little far apart from each other. So my dear friends, what happens is, let's say you're talking about refractive index. Very simple idea, okay? Let's say you're talking about refractive index. You want to say light aayega, some deflection. Some type of refractive index exists in the X-axis. In the Y-axis, do you understand the deflection will be different? Do you understand? The diagram is very shabby, I know. But the point is that in the x-axis, since the arrangement of atoms is different compared to the y-axis, the physical property like refractive index will be different in the x-axis compared to, let's say, in the y-axis. Yes? This type of a behavior is known as anisotropy. Anisotropic. Not isotropic. Isotropic means uniform all over the place. crystalline solids, because of their different arrangements in different axes, have different values of these physical properties. If you, let's say, measure the refractive index diagonally, then you see how different it will be. Yeah, if you measure the refractive index diagonally, then it'll be even more different. So at different axes, at different directions, anisotropy. My dear friends, just a common example that I'll give you. As you know, on catalysis, we start comparing things with regular observations. How many of you are wearing spectacles? Can you tell me? How many of you are wearing spectacles? Venkatesh is worried about Billu. Billu and Leona are sleeping in the other room right now. Okay. So spectacles काफी लोग पहनते होंगे यार. These days it's very common. I also have powered spectacles. ठीक है. Now in spectacles there are multiple types of defects. There's myopia, hypermetropia, and then there is astigmatism. Have you heard of astigmatism? मेरा phone vibrate कर रहा है. इसको silent करने दो मुझे जरा. हाँ जी. ठीक है. So have you heard of astigmatism? What happens in astigmatism is that the lens of the eye becomes elongated. In very simple terms, the lens that you have in the eye becomes elongated. So it's not a perfect sphere anymore. It becomes elongated, something like this. So what happens is that the horizontal lines will appear in a different manner. The vertical lines will appear in a different manner. The horizontal lines will appear different. Okay. The vision gets squashed in one particular axis. Now, I hope you understand that the deformation is not just in this direction. If this is the spherical lens, this is not the only deformation that astigmatism can have. It can be in any direction. Aisa bhi ho sakta hai aapka eye, your eye can get deformed like this, your eye can get deformed like this, etc. So the thing is, I also have astigmatism, all right, and I have different axes in my eye. What does that mean? It means that a certain axis in my eye is the least visible. एक certain axis होगा जिसके around मेरी आँख को सही अच्छे से चीजें दिखती नहीं हैं. So the glasses that we use for astigmatism, if you try to move them around, you will get an entirely different image of the world around you. Okay, let me try to do it. ये कैमरा के साथ करने की कोशिश करता हूँ. I am not sure whether this will work, but I'll try to show you how changing the direction of the glass changes the image. Can you see how my? चलो मैं थोड़ा कोशिश करता हूँ. कुछ तो दिखेगा आपको. Yeah. So this is the looking glass that I'm using. As I rotate the glass, you see how the vision is changing. Yeah. Given the direction of the glass, ये उल्टा करके दिखाता हूँ. Can you see, as I'm moving the glass, the image that you observe is changing. थोड़ा weird हो रहा है. It's a little weird. Yeah. ठीक है. It's a little weird to see. So the thing is, this glass is not regular glass. Okay, this is made up of a special crystalline material, which has a property that at different axes, it will show you different things. And that idea is called anisotropy. At different axes, because of the crystalline arrangement, you will see different things. Yeah, that is what anisotropy is. तो यहां पे वापस आ जाएंगे. Crystalline solids are anisotropic. Their electrical and mechanical properties like refractive index are different in different directions. Practical example. Cool. Now compare that to amorphous solids. Okay. Amorphous solids are isotropic. Take it with a pinch of salt. Isotropic on an average. Okay. Amorphous solids are isotropic on an average because their arrangement is not very definite. In this direction, it is as random it is in this direction. It is as random as it is in this direction. I'll repeat this statement in Hindi and I'll again repeat this statement in English. Amorphous solids itne ajeeb hote hain ki jitna randomness is direction mein hai overall, utna hi random is direction mein hai overall, utna hi random is direction mein overall. So overall, on an average, they are isotropic in nature. ठीक है. The amorphous solids in this direction are as random as they are in this direction, are as random as they are in this direction. So because in all directions they are equally random, in all directions, overall, they give you the same value of the properties. So they are isotropic in nature. Although, if you take a tiny amount of amorphous solid from here, tiny amount of amorphous solid from here, they might have different properties because their arrangements might be different. But on an average, their properties in all directions are the same. Yeah. So amorphous solids are isotropic. Their physical properties have same values in all directions on an average. This is the most interesting point over here that I see. काफी मजा आता है ये सोच के मुझे. Anyway, I will move on now. Some more points of distinction, and I am pretty sure this will interest a lot of people. Yeah. This will interest a lot of people. We'll have a good discussion on it. Anyway, when a crystal breaks into smaller pieces, fragmentation occurs along the crystalline edges, and the smaller pieces have the same characteristic angles as the original crystal. Uniformity. Bigger crystal, break it apart, smaller crystal and bigger crystal have same types of properties. Yeah. Amorphous solids, when fragmented, they cut into irregular surfaces. Yeah. I'm pretty sure you've seen images of diamonds. Yeah. Diamonds have that very uniform structure where you have all those hexagonal type edges on them. Yeah. No matter how small a diamond is, how big a diamond is, the shapes look pretty similar. But if you have different pieces of coal, you know, you can never have two same type of pieces of coal. Yeah. They're so random in nature. Anyway, then comes the idea that they are true solids. True solid. And they are pseudo solids or super cold liquids. Pseudo bole to fake. Okay. I am sure you've heard about the word pseudo for the first time when you heard about pseudopodia in biology. You remember? Fake feet, kuch aisa hota na? Fake feet of some microorganisms or something. Pseudopodia. That's how much I remember biology. I don't know much about it anymore. But the thing is, pseudo solids are, they are called fake solids, okay? And sometimes they are called super cool liquids. Now, I am sure there is so much hype about super cool liquids that you know about the super cool property of glass. Do you know that? So, ab is pe discussion karte. This is one of my favorite points to discuss. Yeah? Amoeba wagera, haan. False. Pseudo is false or fake. Yeah? So, chalo. A lot of people have read, and you must have heard it online, and even in the NCERT it says that glass is a supercooled liquid. Have you read this? They'll tell you that when we look at these ancient glasses that are present in old buildings, we see that at the bottom they are thicker than at the top. Why does this phenomena occur? Scientists think that it is because at the bottom the liquid has settled down. Yeah, something like that. Kaun phone kiya ja raha hai? Yeah. Sorry for that, a friend was calling. Aaj pata nahi kya ho raha hai. Phone baje ja raha hai. Yeah. Have you heard those explanations? That the glass is a liquid, so over the years it has settled down at the bottom, and at the top as it has become thin. Pretty sure you've heard that. My dear friends, the fun thing is, recent studies suggest, although this is what is given in the NCERT, this is what you will have to write in the examination as well, because this is in the NCERT, but recent studies suggest that this is actually false. Okay, NCERT says the statement is true, and you will have to consider it true because the government prescribed syllabus says it is true. But recent studies suggest that this is actually a wrong statement. Then why are those glasses thicker at the bottom? Why is the glass thinner at the top and thick at the bottom in windows of old buildings? My dear friends, the idea is, सोच के देखना. ओके, सोच के देखना. दिस इज द सरफेस एंड आई हैव अ ब्लॉक लाइक दिस. ओके, लेट्स से आई हैव अ ब्लॉक ऑफ वुड लाइक दिस. इट इज शेप लाइक दिस. हाउ वुड यू कीप इट ऑन द सरफेस? वुड यू कीप इट इन दिस मैनर और वुड यू कीप इट इन दिस मैनर? Which of these configurations is more stable? Let's say this is the surface, this is a block of wood, this is the same block of wood. How would you keep it?
obviously yaar, the left side is more stable. This will fall apart.
Yeah. This will keep moving. So the thing is, a lot of scientists, especially in the areas of history and geology, etc. मुझे एग्जैक्ट नहीं पता कौन सी डोमेन के लोग हैं, बट आई हैव रेड अबाउट इट दैट इन ओल्ड डेज द प्रोसेस ऑफ मेकिंग ग्लास वॉज नॉट वेरी गुड. इन ओल्ड डेज द एक्चुअल प्रोसेस ऑफ मेकिंग ग्लास वॉज नॉट वेरी परफेक्ट. सो वेन एवर दे मेड अ लॉन्ग शीट ऑफ ग्लास, इट वॉज थिकर ऑन वन साइड एंड थिनर ऑन द अदर साइड. जब वो बनाते थे ना ग्लास का शीट, वो पहले से ही एक जगह थिक होता था, एक जगह थिन होता था, क्योंकि ग्लास मेकिंग प्रोसेस इतनी परफेक्ट नहीं थी. That is one theory, okay? So this theory says that since the glass making process was not perfect in the history, already there was one side thicker than the other side in the glass because of the property. See, how is glass made? You melt a lot of silica, yes? Silica ke kuch kuch cheezon ko melt karte ho, and once they melt at very high temperatures, you've seen those glass making people. There's a Netflix series on glass making. ठीक है. एंड देन दे कूल इट डाउन इन टू सर्टन शेप्स. सो वेन दे मेड दीज ह्यूज शीट्स ऑफ ग्लास, वेन दे कूल्ड इट डाउन, इट वॉज ऑटोमेटिकली बाय डिफॉल्ट थिकर ऑन वन साइड, थिनर ऑन द अदर साइड, बिकॉज ऑफ द प्रोसेस एट दैट टाइम. एंड दैट इज वाई दे चोज टू कीप इट लाइक दिस. दे डेलिबरेटली चोज टू कीप द थिकर साइड एट द बॉटम एंड थिनर साइड एट द टॉप. सो देर आर टू थ्योरीज टू इट. सम पीपल विल से दैट इट इज अ सुपर कूल लिक्विड, बट सम अदर रिसर्च सजेस्ट दैट the glass was made that way because the glass making process was not perfect, and that is why they kept the thicker pieces at the bottom so that it doesn't fall off easily. So it's a very interesting thing. Aditya dost, aisi baat hai ki hindi mein baki sare youtube channels jo hain vedantu ke wo padhate hain, jitne bhi youtube channel hain baki wo hindi mein padhate hain. So mera channel jo hai english mein apan zyada padhate hain dost. So hindi mein padhne ke liye aap baki vedantu ke channels ko subscribe kar sakte ho. All right. Anyway, so it's a doubtful statement. Anyway, so what it means is supercooled liquid means that it is essentially a liquid, it's a fluid, but it is so tightly packed, it has such a high viscosity. Do you understand viscosity? Honey is more viscous than water. So supercooled liquids are essentially liquids which have very high viscosity that they can't really move around like a fluid easily. So some theories suggest that amorphous solids are as good as supercooled liquids, but take this theory with a pinch of salt. I mean, this is some people say it is true, some people say it is not true. Okay, so I'll just add a question mark next to this point. This is what is mentioned in a lot of basic books, but when you start looking at a different angle of research, not very good statements to say. Anyway, examples are good. They possess symmetry, as I told you, uniform structures, symmetrical structures, NaCl, diamond, CaCl, KCl, etc., etc., crystalline. And amorphous, you know the examples, glass, plastic, starch, rubber, etc. They don't possess any specific symmetry in them. Theek hai ji? So it's a nice discussion that we had in the beginning. And Shreya is saying, please start live sessions for 2022. We have been doing live sessions for 2022 students since May. We have already covered atomic structure, periodic properties, chemical bonding, gaseous state, and we are doing thermodynamics right now. We've already also done mole concept. All of those were done in live classes. So Shreya, please, my humble request to you is open the channel before spamming the chat box. Theek hai? 2022 ke liye classes have been going on since 4 months now. Okay. Chitti Rishikesh is asking, sir, please explain today's mains paper. No, I will not do that. I have promised to my regular students that we will not see the papers until all the examinations are done. Okay. Let's say you have your examination on 5th. You start solving today's paper today. You will feel nervous, man. You will feel underconfident. If 2 questions are harder than you expected, then you will feel very sad for the main examination. Stop doing it. चलो तो ये हो गया, बढ़िया. नाउ माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, दिस वाज जस्ट फैक्ट्स. अब थोड़ा आगे बढ़ते हैं एंड लेट अस नाउ डिस्कस अबाउट द डिफरेंट अरेंजमेंट्स दैट यू कैन हैव इन अ क्रिस्टलाइन सॉलिड. बिफोर आई गेट इनटू दैट, ओके, बिफोर आई गेट इनटू ऑल ऑफ दिस, व्हाट इज अ लैटिस एंड एटसेट्रा, व्हाट इज अ यूनिट सेल, लेट मी आस्क यू वन क्वेश्चन. ओके, लेट मी आस्क यू वन क्वेश्चन. दैट क्वेश्चन इज, यूल बी लाइक, हैं ये क्या पूछ रहे हो,
What is wavelength? Bataiye ji.
What do we mean by wavelength? Yeah, can you tell me? Boxer, no, the chapter is not boring. It's a very interesting chapter. Janvi saying, so there may not be anything called supercooled liquids. There are some crystals that are supercooled liquids, not crystals, sorry. There are some things that are called supercooled liquids because it has been experimentally verified that once in 200 years, they will leave a drop if kept in a vessel where there is a tiny hole at the bottom. So you can search for those online. There are these different types of liquids. I'll show you the examples in the next class maybe. But yeah, there are proper supercooled liquids, but glass may not be a supercooled liquid and amorphous solids may not be, you know, a good classification for supercooled liquids. Anyway, so what is wavelength? Some people are saying length of the wave. That's like, you will get 0 marks for that answer. Yeah. Length which is covered in a specific time period. Prem, okay. Distance between two consecutive crests, okay. Still a better definition. Nana Prakash is also saying distance between two crests or two troughs. Better definitions are possible. Okay. Better definitions are possible. Shreya, playlist mein jaake dekho bachche, mil jayega aapko. Shreya, just open the playlist of the channel. You will see series called What's in the Atom, The Epic Mole, Periodic Classification, Chemical Bonding. All of those are there. Just open the playlist, please. Okay, mil jayega. So, chalo. Wavelength. I'll give you a very beautiful definition today. It'll change your perspective of how you look at the wavelength. Most likely, you said distance between two crests, different distance between two troughs. That is correct. That gives you the value of the wavelength. But technically speaking, wavelength is the smallest part of the wave. Okay, write this down if you want to. Smallest part of the wave that can be repeated. Okay, that can be repeated to create the entire wave. Do you understand? Read it. Wavelength is the smallest part of the wave that can be repeated to create the entire wave again and again. This is a wave. Okay. Some of you will say that, sir, this much is wavelength. Okay, correct. That can be repeated to get the entire wave. But my conjecture is, not conjecture, my point is, if I repeat the wave from this point to this point, it is still wavelength, yeah? This length is still wavelength. If I take a very random point, let's say I take this point. If I repeat from here to here, I can again keep on creating the wave. Isn't it? Yeah. So this part, it is neither the distance between two crests, it is neither the distance between two troughs, but this still is the wavelength. So the most broad definition, the most apt definition of a wavelength is that part of the wave that you can repeat again and again to create the entire wave. Yeah? Samajh rahe ho? So wavelength is essentially the smallest part of the wave. Do you understand this much? Wavelength can be called the smallest part of the wave. Because any smaller than that, you can't recreate the wave. If it's small, the wave will not be able to make it again. Use this, I can create the whole wave again. If I just do Ctrl-C, Ctrl-V, Ctrl-C, Ctrl-V, Ctrl-C, Ctrl-V, yeah? Fine. So, my dear friends, wavelength is the smallest part of the wave. Let's change this definition. What is a unit cell? It is the smallest part of the crystal that can be repeated to create the entire crystal. This is what a unit cell is. Unit cell essentially is the smallest part of the entire crystal. Okay, What is a crystal? You know, solid exists as a crystal. Hey, bada sara diamond. If you have this bigger diamond, you will be the richest person on the world, I guess. But the point is that if you have a crystalline structure, solid crystal, must take them. If you take out a tiny little unit from that crystal, which you can repeat again and again in three dimensions to get the entire crystal, is known as the unit cell. Do you understand the definition of the unit cell now? So I will show you an image that will make it even more obvious for you. Crystal lattice. Okay, what is the meaning of the word lattice? Lattice just means regular arrangement, that's all. Okay, crystal lattice is basically the regular arrangement of atoms or ions inside the crystal. So the regular arrangement of building blocks, atoms, ions or molecules inside the crystalline solid is called the crystal lattice. Okay, theek hai? The smallest part of a lattice, which can be repeated in all directions to generate the entire lattice, to generate the entire crystal yet again, is known as the unit cell. So this is the arrangement, as you can see in 3D. Yeah, this tiny little unit can be repeated in all directions to create the entire unit cell once again. So basically, crystal lattice is the entire structure of the solid. If the wall of the house is the entire lattice, then the smallest unit, then you can think of the smallest unit as the brick that is making the wall. Yeah, Kaushik, the class started at 7 PM, brother. DM Kids YT is asking, will you do 11th? We have already done a lot of chapters of 11th. We do 11th class series on this channel as well. Thermodynamics is going on right now, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday at 7 PM. Okay, Mansi, I'm glad you enjoyed Epic GOC. Theek hai doston, so these are things that you might sorry, I live right next to a highway. These are things that you might want to write down. Ye cheezein likh lo, to thoda bhala ho jayega tumhara. These are the things that they will ask you in board examinations as well. So yeah, cool. Suryansh is here in 10th class. Suryansh, I hope you're understanding whatever we are discussing today, because these are pretty simple things. Okay, Noman, can you tell me what is the exact doubt that you have? If you want me to repeat everything, just rewind the class and watch it again. It's on YouTube, thankfully. If you have a doubt, then tell me. I will tell that to you. Nihit is asking for a blue turban. Bro, the problem with the blue turban is that it doesn't match with the Vedantu t-shirt. And if I don't wear the Vedantu t-shirt, then the operations people call me and say, sir, aapne t-shirt nahi pehna aaj Vedantu ka. So just so that it matches with my turban, I'm wearing something that goes better with this black t-shirt. Dheeraj Kumar Singh is asking, are you Japanese? I am Japanese. Konnichiwa. Anirudh, of course, important hai, sabse basic cheez hai ye. Anik equilibrium, we will do it, Prem, eventually. We will do it right now for 11th class, thermodynamics is going on. Then we will do chemical equilibrium, then ionic equilibrium. Eventually, wo bhi ho jayega. Okay? Ojas is in 7th class. Very nice, Ojas. I hope you're having fun. Badhiya. Nana Prakash is saying, please enable slow mode. People are spamming around. See, if you are serious about the class, just forget about the chat box. You can ask me a doubt in the comment later. I will answer you. Not a problem. Chalo. Ye likh liya hoga. So this is a crystal lattice. So my dear friends, this unit cell. Now you understand, this unit cell is all we need to study. If we study one unit cell properly, we can study the entire solid structure. So now we need to understand what are the different types of arrangements that I can do in a solid unit cell. Make sense? तो दोस्तों कैसे हो सकते हैं यूनिट सेल, सोच के बताओ जरा. यहां पे एम्प्टी पेज है ना, थिंक अबाउट इट. व्हाट कुड बी द डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ यूनिट सेल्स. सी, वन यूनिट सेल कुड बी वेयर आई पुट वन एटम ओवर हियर, अनदर एटम ओवर हियर, अनदर एटम ओवर हियर, अनदर एटम ओवर हियर, परफेक्टली स्क्वायर स्ट्रक्चर. नाउ सिंस माय सॉलिड इज 3D, आई पुट अ स्क्वायर स्ट्रक्चर ऑल ओवर द प्लेस. एक क्यूब बना देते हैं, मस्त एकदम ऐसा. Do you agree that this could be a very beautiful unit cell? If I keep repeating this, I will get the entire solid. Yeah. So, unit cell could be something very simple like a cube. Instead of a cube, some people will say, sir, I don't want a cube, I want to make a hexagon. बनाओ हेक्सागन, इफ इट्स योर विश देन मेक द हेक्सागन। ऐसा मस्त एकदम बना दिया, समथिंग लाइक दिस, डू यू गेट द आइडिया? मस्त हेक्सागोनल स्ट्रक्चर बना दिया, दैट कैन ऑल्सो बी अ यूनिट सेल। ओके, सो देर आर डिफरेंट डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ यूनिट सेल्स दैट आर पॉसिबल। Alright, there are different types of unit cells that are possible. Now we need to understand that unit cells have to be thought of in a very specific manner. अपने को ये सोचना है, we have to think how many different types of unit cells are possible. We have to think how many different types of unit cells are possible. Now think about the hexagonal unit cell. Okay, अगर मैं इस hexagon की बात करूं, इमेजिन दिस हेक्सागन इज अ सिलेंडर दैट एग्जिस्ट बिहाइंड द बोर्ड एज वेल। तो मस्त ऐसा कुछ हेक्सागन एग्जिस्ट कर रहा है। ओके, दिस इज समथिंग लाइक दिस एग्जिस्ट। डू यू रियलाइज देर आर स्मॉलर फ्रेगमेंट्स विच आई कैन रिपीट टू मेक द एंटायर यूनिट सेल? इंस्टेड ऑफ टेकिंग द हेक्सागन एंटायरली, आई कैन रिपीट अ स्मॉलर यूनिट। लेट्स से आई हैव सेल, आई हैव सॉलिड्स ऑन दीज पॉइंट्स। Okay, I have solids on all the corners and I have a solid on the center. Instead of repeating the entire hexagon again and again, do you realize I can repeat just this much unit? What was the definition of the unit cell? The unit cell's definition was that the smallest unit that can be repeated to create the entire cell. Agreed that you can recreate the hexagon in all directions, banate raho, but do you realize that this unit, if you repeat, will again give you all the hexagons once again? Yeah, kar do repeat, yahan pe hexagon ban jayenge aapke. Keep on repeating it, wo hexagon banate raho utha utha ke. Fine. So my dear friends, that is the point. We have to choose the smallest possible case. We have to choose the smallest possible unit. So when scientists did a lot of analysis on this, they came up with the idea that there are 7 different arrangements of these 3D unit cells that are possible. So I'll just give you an idea right now and then we'll end the class. So various lattices can be formed by varying the unit cell parameters. So you think about this type of a structure. Okay, ye cube hai, this is a 3D structure, basic 3D structure where there are multiple values that you can change. There are multiple variables that you can change. So what are the variables? Let's think about a corner. Okay, on this corner, do you realize there are 3 types of angles? There is one angle over here, let's call it alpha. This angle, let's call it beta. This angle, let's call it gamma. Alpha, beta, gamma, these different angles can be changed. These are known as interfacial angles. Okay, if this is your unit cell, these are the angles that are alpha, beta and gamma. If you keep varying the different angles, the type of unit cell changes. The 3D structure is changing essentially. And also the length of the unit cells can be changed. This length is A, this length is B, this length is C, whatever, A, B, C. Edge lengths, the lengths of different edges of the unit cell, that can also be changed. And once you make the unit cell, where do you have to put the atoms? That can also be changed. So first we need to figure out what are the different possibilities by changing the edge length and the interfacial angles. Once we've considered all the possibilities, then in all those possibilities, we can place atoms at different locations. I can place atoms at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 locations. That are the 8 corners. This could be one type of unit cell where the atoms are at all corners of the unit cell. Another arrangement could be where I have atoms at all the corners, okay, fine. But I have one atom right in the center of the unit cell as well. This could be one arrangement that I can keep continuing, etc., etc. So all of these different arrangements exist in the world. I'll just give you an idea. We'll discuss about this again in the next class. There are different crystal systems, okay. Cubic system is which system? Where edge lengths are all equal to each other and interfacial angles that I just showed you are exactly 90 degree from each other. Then you have tetragonal, which is like a 3D cuboid, okay. Cuboid basically. So tetragonal mein A is equal to B, but it is not equal to C. Yeah, so samajh rahe ho na, this is simple cubic cube. And then you have your tetragonal system where one length is a little more elongated. So this is alpha equal to beta equal to gamma, all are 90 degrees, so one length is elongated. Orthorhombic mein, the lengths are not equal, but all the angles are still 90 degree. different variations exist, and this is what we will discuss in the upcoming class. So the upcoming class involves the discussion of different crystal systems that we can have: cubic, tetragonal, orthorhombic, rhombohedral, etc. And then we will understand ideas about Bravais lattices. When we look in nature and try to find out what are the different types of arrangements of atoms possible in these crystal systems, we figure out that there are 14 possible arrangements, and those are called Bravais lattices. Okay, so we will discuss that in the upcoming class. So my dear friends, we are excited to announce NCRT channel for 11th and 12th. The link is in the description box down below. It's a channel where we discuss things about the NCRT. Yeah, everything related to the NCRT, all the theory, all the examples, etc., etc. And you can join a full course at Vedantu. Yes, this is basically the link for the full course. You know, those proper subscription courses where you will get all the study material, all the live classes on Vedantu's patented platform. You will be given mock tests, etc. It's like joining Vedantu as an online coaching institute. So the link is in the description box. This is the coupon code that you can use to get yourself a discount. I'll tell you that the next class for solid state is going to be on Friday at 7 p.m. Okay, so aaj kya tarikh hai? Today it is the 2nd. So the next class is going to be there on the 4th of September at 7 p.m. So in that class we will discuss about different types of unit cells and Bravais lattices. Okay, unit cells and Bravais lattices. Cool. So that is the discussion that we'll have in the upcoming class. And also it would be amazing if you could read the first few pages of the NCRT. At least read till the end of Bravais lattices, NCRT solid state. If you don't have the book, the PDF is available online. Just search for NCRT solid state 12th class PDF. You will get PDF from the official government website. Cool. So this is a tiny little assignment for you. Today's class was more talking, less solving. Eventually the classes will turn into more solving, less talking, which will be a little more fun for all of you. So in case you are new, if you enjoyed the class, please make sure you hit that like button, stay subscribed, and we will see each other very soon. I'll chat with you guys for 2-3 minutes and then we will end the class. Okay. Karthik is saying, how to remember these? You don't need to remember all of these, so it's fine. Ayan is saying, give a mnemonic code. I'll try to search for one. If I find a good one, then yeah, definitely. Vemuru, yeah man, even I am excited. Suryan, it's not a problem, man. Ek second, kya chal raha hai yahan pe? Please ask Vedantu J people to not. Vidit, you just don't watch it, man. There will be hundreds of YouTube channels that will solve the J papers because it gives a lot of views. Hai na? Mujhe views ki itni badi nahi hai. So, you just don't watch it, that's all. Cool. Important topics of this chapter. Dipanshu, we'll do the important topics eventually. One part is understanding the basic idea behind Bravais lattices, then understanding what are voids, what are the radius ratios of the voids, and what are the defects. So those are the main important topics. So we'll cover everything eventually. Okay? How many classes will it take? Shiva, I am assuming it'll take 2-3 weeks of time. Let's see. I'll try to make it as crisp and fast as possible, while still keeping it all understandable. ठीक है, बढ़िया. अर्नव दोस्त, हिंदी में ना बाकी सभी चैनल पढ़ा रहे हैं यूट्यूब के, तो मेरा चैनल जो है वेदांतु पे, वो स्पेसिफिकली इंग्लिश के लिए है. हिंदी में पढ़ने के लिए वेदांतु के जितने भी बाकी चैनल हैं, आप वेदांतु सर्च करोगे तो आपको बाकी चैनल मिल जाएंगे. सब हिंदी में पढ़ा रहे हैं, आप पढ़ सकते हो वहां से. ठीक है, चलो जी, कूल. सो पीपल, that's it from my side for today's class. Thank you so much for joining in. And if you have any more doubts, if you have any more queries that you want to ask me, then leave it in the comment section down below. Until next time, take care. See you soon.